So welcome everyone. Just before we go to the agenda, we have a few information to highlight what is IRTF and what we do in the research group. So the IRTF Internet Research Task Force conducts research. It is not a standards development organization. And the IRTF focuses on longer term research issues related to the internet. And whereas the IETF Engineering Task Force focuses on short-term issues of engineering and standards making. So while the IETF can publish informational or experimental documents in the RFC series, its primary goal is to promote development of research collaboration and teamwork in exploring research issues related to internet protocols, applications, architecture, and technology. And if you want to have a bit more detail about the scope and aspects related to IRTF, you have a link to one of the documents. That said, there is also some policies in place. So the IRTF follows IETF policies. And this slide here on screen and my statement here is a reminder of IETF policies in effect on various topics such as patents or code of conduct. And so the point here is that to make you aware of those different policies, and that by participating to this meeting, you agree to comply with those policies. And you have a bit of a summary in this slide, and also some pointers to the different best current practices documents that details the different policies. I think this is virtual meeting etiquette well known for you. So the session will be recording and is being recorded. Please keep yourself muted if you're not talking. And if you would like to raise some comments or speak, usually the chairs will handle the queue. So based on the agenda, but if you want to raise comments during presentation or after presentation, please just type RH, raise hand, in the chat window, and we will give you the floor so that we can manage the line. You are welcome also to state your name when you start speaking so that we can also record in the minutes who was making the comment, and it's easier to track, especially for new participants. A few useful links. I think if you are here, you already touched base with all these different links, but the recording will be available on the YouTube channel slightly after the meetings. And for those that have not done it yet, please add your name to the bottom of the notes page. You have the link here and also in the chat window of the WebEx session. This will be very welcome from you. So agenda, today we try to keep a bit of room to have more technical discussion on the IBA use cases, which will be point number 4 of the agenda. So point number 1 is what I'm doing now, meeting introduction. I give also the floor to Nikhil for a quick introduction. We have been in touch with Nikhil recently because what he is doing with Forward Networks falls in the scope of our IBM activities, and we welcome Nikhil to participate in the group and present to us a bit of their innovation and interest in this topic. Second item will be status on IBM concept and definitions. I'm not sure if Alex will do that or I will do it, but it will be very quick. Third point will be status on intent classification. Olga will give us this update, and we will have also a discussion on the next step for this draft. Then the big piece for today is the IBM use cases work session. We plan around an hour of work on that. And we apologize for the late notice, and so maybe we will lack a bit of preparation, but our idea is to highlight a few presentations or introduction to use cases in the scope of NMRG. We already have a couple of documents that are slightly along the line of use cases, so if we can use that as a starting point, this will be quite useful. And then clarify what we want to achieve with the use case work in NMRG on IBM. And how to use these, for instance, as inputs to the reference model or document lessons from the validation of the use cases. And also the end result, by that I mean a bit which shape we would like to give to these IBM use cases. Last point in this session will be what do we want or what do we need to document? So what do we, what type of content we want to put in those use cases? It could be documents, it could be also maybe prototypes or other things, but at least common description, requirements, functional blocks, validation aspects. So this is a bit of an open list, and we need to discuss more precisely what we would like to investigate on those and document for the use cases. Point number five in the agenda, it's just a quick information about activities on the topic of IBM that is happening outside of NMRG. So essentially things I'm aware of in ZSM and TMF, there are also a couple of other things. So this is just to highlight ongoing activities and try to find a positioning of NMRG towards that, whether we need to do something or just be aware. Point number six, probably Jérôme, if we still have time, we'll give a quick status on the research challenges in AI for network management. But I don't think there are so much updates on that, but we can still have time to go through that. And any other business or any other topics you'd like to discuss in the remaining time. Is it okay for you? Do you have any questions while we are on the agenda? If there are no questions, I'd like to take the opportunity to introduce Nikhil Handigal. So Nikhil, if you can say a few words, and I don't know if you have anything you would like to put forward, that will be of interest to us. Thank you.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. I just my name is Nikhil Handigal. I just wanted to say hello to everyone and introduce myself and briefly talk about why I'm excited to be here. Is it okay if I share something on the screen?
Yes, please.
Okay, perfect. Let me share my screen. All right.
Nikhil, just before you continue, we may have to see if the slides you will be presenting will have to be contributed to the materials of the meeting, because as I said, we have some policies about contributions to meetings, and I think
this is just I'm not presenting anything proprietary. I just wanted to introduce myself and why I'm here. Yeah,
we will contribute that to the materials after.
Absolutely. Yeah,
just checking. Thank you.
Yeah. Hello everyone. I just wanted to put a face to the name. My name is Nikhil Handigal. I'm a co-founder of Forward Networks, and we are working in the network assurance and network verification space, and in the intent-based networking space at large. My background is I have a PhD in computer science from Stanford, and a good most of my PhD was around software-defined networking and OpenFlow, network troubleshooting and network emulation. As part of the research group that pretty much pioneered software-defined networking, this is Nick McKeown's group at Stanford. And what we do at Forward Networks, Forward Networks is a 7-year-old company. We were founded in 2013. We are based out of the Bay Area, and we are 4 founders in the company, and we all have a similar background in the sense that we all came from the SDN OpenFlow background from Stanford. We all have PhDs. We are a Series C company funded by some of the largest companies. And I just wanted to talk about why this group and the work that this group is doing is so relevant to us. We view intent-based networking as basically comprising of 2 buckets. It's intent fulfillment, which is the ability to take intent and map it to the network infrastructure, and intent assurance, which is look at the network infrastructure and ensure that it meets the intent. So Forward Networks squarely falls in the latter bucket. We are in the intent assurance or network verification space. So we look at the configuration and state of the actual network devices, infer the behavior of the network, and validate or verify that the actual behavior matches the intent. So regardless of which bucket one's interest lies, intent is the key. How we define it, I think having a comprehensive and universal framework for intent is the key. And that's the reason the work that this group is doing, I think, is so important. And that's the reason I'm here. So I would love to engage with this group and learn and contribute as much as possible. With that, I'll end my screen share.
Thanks, Nick. for the quick introduction and welcome to the work of Enermergy. So I think, yes, as you said, it seems that what you are doing on forward networks is right on spot with some of the activities of Enermergy on IBN, and we'll be glad, I mean, to have more participants, more reviews, more contributions on this topic. So thank you. Welcome. Let me share again where we stand on the agenda. So we will move to point number two, status on IBN concept and definition. I'm just checking with Alex. I think, Alex, you're online. Not sure whether you like to give the quick update or I do it. At least the slides I have are the ones we use for the last meetings, because I think our update are still a bit in the pipe for us as author of this document. So please let me know if you'd like to give an update or I do that.
I think I'm fine either way. I think, well, why don't you give the update? I think we are trying to, right, we need to sync up amongst ourselves. I think we have updates in the pipeline. So I made a bunch of edits addressing basically the comments that were made to the document, but we have not posted it because we still need to coordinate.
Yeah, okay, so maybe just for the entire research group, this is will be a quick recap. So the status on intent-based networking concept and definition draft, so this is a research group document, currently version 2, and as Alex mentioned, we are working on a third version, still a bit in the editing pipe on our side. So this was presented in the last Enermergy meeting in IATF in November. This is where, in fact, we had the version 2 posted, and we received, we made updates based on comments received on the mailing list, reviews received on the mailing list, and also some rework of the version 1 towards version 2. So this is a more technical rework of the document. But what was more recent at that time in November was that we were just out of the research group last call. So that was happening from, around the month of October. The shepherd of the document is Jérôme François, which is one of the Enermergy co-chair. And he has shared his conclusions mid of November. So we received quite support for the document to move forward towards IRC reviews, and also a few relatively detailed reviews. So out of this outcome of the research group last fall, with the authors, we were proposing the next step, the following next steps. First one, to issue new version. So -3, this is what we are currently working on. Initially, we thought we would be able to post it end of last year, but it was a bit too challenging to do that. So we are still working on that, and the next version should be out quite soon. Then out of this new version, depending on the amount of changes that we reflect in the new document based on the outcome of the research group last fall, it will be up to the shepherd to evaluate whether those changes are minor, and so to validate that on the mailing list and be able to move the documents towards IRSG reviews in the end of the IRTF chair, or if the changes are considered more major and possibly go to a second research group last fall. So we are currently still at step one. And then third step will be to submit to IRG review to go towards informational RFC publication. And I think that's it for the status. Nothing really more to say. I mean, we really try to address the different comments. We have a kind of to-do list of things we want to update on the document. And as soon as the new version is ready, you will hear from us. Are there any questions on this document, or what will be your views on next step on this? Okay, seems we are quite clear with you on that. So the next point in the agenda, which will be the status on the other research group document in terms of classification. And I will leave the floor to Olga to give the presentation. Just let me get slides.
Do you want me to share or will you?
I can share.
Okay, thanks.
If you're okay with that, just let me know if you want to move forward. Yeah,
thanks. So, hello everybody. I'm going to present the latest status update on the intent classification draft. So these are, as you know, at the authors, co-authors of the draft. We can go to the next slide. Yeah, so I'll just do very brief introduction for those who are here first time, like we did kind of present this draft several times and different versions of the draft, but just very brief introduction. So this draft proposes intent classification methodology, and the reason for that is to be able to identify the scope and priorities of individual projects, POCs, research initiatives, and open source projects in the NMIG. The output of our intent classification methodology that we proposed is an example of the intent taxonomy that we created, and it describes different solutions, user types, different intent types, intent scopes, network scopes, and abstractions, and also life cycle identification of the life cycle requirements. We started from the three solutions, but those solutions could be extended or updated. We also used the ITF 108 POC multi-layer approach for IBN as an example for our proposed classification methodology, and we went through the classification for carrier and data center solution that the POC described. Next slide, please. So this is the timeline. The draft was adopted by the research group on 1st of July 2020, and we are here, like I'm doing status update on the version 2. We just submitted version 2 and here is the link, and we also posted it on Git, and we addressed all the comments. So after adoption, we received 38 comments. So when we submitted version 1, we were not able to address all of them, but now we addressed all 38 comments. And the main updates, there were many of them, but I'm just talking about the most important updates in the document. We sharpened our draft position in relation to the concepts and overview draft. We provided detailed description of the intent classification methodology workflow, and we extended section which was doing previously describing it. We integrated Barbara and Walter's POC into the draft and used it as an example for classification. So we added sections 733 and 743 with examples of how we used our methodology to identify the scope of this POC, both in carrier and data center use cases. Also, we did the classification on requirements for different intent types based on the contents, that's section 5.2. We addressed the benefits of intent to network requirements, it's section 5.3. There were kind of, we had the scope and definition defined throughout, but there were comments that we really would benefit from a separate scope section and separate definition section. So we introduced these two sections, and we moved things that were talking about the scope and some definitions into those sections. And we also did numerous readability improvements. So next. So you can see on the next slide, you can see the major changes in the table of content, the new sections that we added, and also the updated sections. So we would appreciate if those who have not been reviewing version 1 of the document, review from the original version 0 and look at both version 1 and version 2. Updates. So these are the major changes if you want to kind of do the additional review. I know that many of you send us our review comments, but at this stage it would be probably another phase of reviews needed. So the next slide. So I think at this stage the draft is stable. We addressed all the comments, so we would like to start the process towards draft publication as informational RFC. So we are asking the chairs to help us.
Thank you, Olga, for the status. I think it's always nice to see that you have addressed all the comments and made the, all those changes in the document. And I will re-insist on the fact that if the research group participants can provide reviews of the document, this is always useful. I mean, quality documents can also start with qualitative reviews. On the proposal to move forward, I think this is very, I mean, timely. I think we have to, I would like to give the floor right now to the research group to express views, whether people have read I mean, have followed the updates and read the latest version. I think it was, but just to see a bit, what's the feedback from the research group participants that are here today about moving forward, their opinion about the latest status of the documents. Then from that, also Jerome and myself, we will I mean, study your request and see what will be the best way forward in terms of especially going into a last research group last call, as we did for the other documents. Because we see that usually these last calls is a good way to trigger a bit more, let's say, formal reviews, which are quite useful for the document. Mm-hmm. So just before we discuss a bit more these next steps, I'd like to give the floor to research group participants. What's your view on this document? Is it stable? Is the content appropriate? Are you supporting that we move forward? Just to get a sense of the consensus of the research group.
So I just want to mention out from the 38 comments, like I can see here, Alex is here. We addressed his comments. We addressed Jerome's comments. We addressed your comment. We addressed Mehdi's here. We addressed Mehdi's comments. So just to let you know that we addressed all the comments. I can't see all other comment authors. They don't seem to be here. Or maybe I'm missing somebody. Thanks.
Sorry. Hi, Olga. Thank you. I wanted just to thank you for the. I received your email and I saw you address my comments. I didn't have the chance to read the latest version, but yeah, I promise I'll have a read through and I'll get back to you if I have any feedback. So. Remarks.
Thanks, Mehdi. Thank you.
Are there other views on this document? I mean, whether you have already read it or not, you have provided comments. Do you require more time? Do you think it's a good thing to move forward with that? It's very informal. I mean, we will anyway bring it to the mailing list if we move toward the research group last call. But here it's just that we have the opportunity in this meeting to hear from you live. So, and I think it will be quite useful for the offers to hear from you.
Jerome speaking. As participant, so thank you, Olga, for also having modified according to my comment. And generally, I think that the document has made a lot of progress with all the comments you address. But of course, I will also need to read globally because I read some parts which have been deleted, but I need personality to read globally again. But yeah, then. As Laurent said, it has to go anyway with the formal call then if you want to progress. And it will trigger, for sure, a lot of detailed review.
Yeah, the code authors, they all agreed that we should press forward with the request for publication. So I can see that from the code authors here, we don't have because China is... now strange times, but we have Adriana and we have Jefferson here who are co-authors. So on our internal email list, we all agreed that we want to push for the request for the publication as information on RFC.
Okay, Olga, I mean, speaking as a research group participant, I appreciate really that you made good work on addressing the numerous comments that you received. I think the draft has really matured since its inception. And I think what you ask is makes sense, also according to the research group milestones, that this initial set of documents on the concepts and this classification slash taxonomy are now ready and stable and could move forward. So I think I will support to go to research group last call with that. And a bit like Jérôme mentioned, I'd like to also make a complete read of the latest version to be able to have a good understanding of it and provide eventually additional comments. But I think what you did already goes in the right direction for that.
Thank you.
Jérôme, just a bit more formally now. I mean, we have this request from the authors. I think we, a bit like we did for the IBN concept draft, so to initiate a research group last call with indication about the criteria we would like to see and the feedback we would like to receive from the research group participants. One aspect we have to anticipate just a bit is about the identifying a shepherd for these documents. You are a shepherd for the other IBN concept draft. I don't know if it's good that you are a shepherd for two of these documents. So we have to see, because I'm co-author of the other one. I don't know if it's also a good option for me to be shepherd for this one. If it's not the case, maybe we will have to seek with other research group participants, or even a bit outside of the energy, if there are people that could be good candidate for this. It's not urgent, but we have to find a good fit for this.
Yes, we have to check that, Laurent. I think it will be good that it will not be me or those Schaefer for this document. I don't know for you it's possible or not. Maybe we have to check, and otherwise we have to find somebody else.
Colin is on the call, but I don't know if he's actively listening. So just Colin, I don't know if you can hear me, but taking the opportunity that you're on the call, just to raise you this question about the shared of this document. Colin?
Hi. Yeah, I am on the call. I'm slightly struggling to hear Jérôme.
Yeah.
Just about, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm mostly struggling to hear what Jérôme is saying.
A question for you will be, I mean, probably the document on internet classification will move towards research group last call, and we are waiting a bit on finding a shepherd for the document. Yeah. Jérôme is shepherd of the other research group document, IBN concept, for which I'm one of the co-authors. So I'm wondering if I could be a shepherd of the intent class, or if this will be a sort of conflict of interest, and if yes, if we need to find another candidate in the research group or outside of the research group. What would be your knowledge or advice for this?
I mean, you're not an author of the intent classification document, are you?
No.
No, I think it would be fine if you were a shepherd for that, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We will check. Okay, thank you. But thanks for the information.
Sure, no problem.
Okay, any comments or people wants to share something on these documents before we move to the next item? Sorry.
Okay, thank you. Thanks. Goodbye.
Okay, so now the big piece. So IBN use cases work session. So what at least I give you my take on it. We have a few participants in the call. I think I would like to hear from them about their opinion for the use cases, because there are actually offers of documents that we could classify as use case, IBM use cases. If they can give a brief overview about their work and how they see this as a use case and what they would like this to become, that would be much appreciated. And I think after this short presentation, I would like to have a collective discussion how we would like to shape this work in NMRG. I mean, we have been on that for a bit more than a couple of meetings, but we are a bit struggling to really get some momentum. We got some interest and feedback on that, so not that people are not interested in doing that, but I think we need to find a way to really reach the next level of details. So for me, that will be already a good objective for this work session on use cases. I don't know if before we go into these short presentations, if others have anything they would like to share in order how to steer this discussion before we start. Okay, so a bit of a support slide. Before giving the floor maybe to Luis, or I don't think Jeff is on the call, but Amina neither, so let's see. But let me just recap briefly what we have in the charter, and especially the IBM work plan on this aspect of use cases. So this is item number 5 of the IBM work plan, and what we put as objective for that is to define appropriate validation scenarios and use cases, describing concrete examples of intent expressions and function, with the goal to assess the quality and completeness of specification and evaluate intent-based system functionality in experimental settings. So when we drafted this item for the work plan, we were not having only a use case approach. It was more like a validation scenario. So this is why there is this phrase in here. But this is in our work plan. We have some milestones related to that. And I think we already have some documents and interest from participants to. What I already said also in the past, I think Jefferson was a bit trying to animate those discussions, are a set of considerations. What are the potential use cases of interest that we could investigate in NMRG? I mean, there are so many different application areas or examples that we may have to select a few of them that we could put forward. Here is a list of some examples. It doesn't mean that it needs to be on that type of use cases, but I think those different domains of application are also providing different aspect of IBM. You see, if you take 5G network slicing type of environment, it sets you into a kind of telecom operator context. So it defines a certain set of actors, certain set of technologies, certain set of intents or operations you would like to be able to see from that kind of intent-driven networks. The other type of use cases on enterprise or data center networking could be a bit quite different, because still in the networking space, the type of actors, the type of technologies, or even, let's say, in data centers, the type of topologies and equipment that you will find there may be a bit different from the type of technologies you will face and actors you will have in the 5G network slicing environment. So we may bring different views and requirements, and maybe functionalities by looking into these different use cases. And the last one on SmartX, it could be smart home, smart city, or transportation, whatever would be the kind of smart environment. I think this, again, puts you into a different context. Again, maybe because the actors, you may have maybe more public type of actor or end users involved. So the type of intents or expectation could be quite different. Maybe you will have a mix of technology that goes beyond purely with the networking and telecommunication space. We will have maybe critical systems, maybe different types of moving vehicles, etc., that could be part of the scenario. Again, this is not prescriptive. I'm not saying that these are the use cases we should investigate, but it was just to highlight that choosing use cases that comes with different facets could also be interesting in what we can get out of them. Then the second point in the consideration is this definition of guidelines, common structure, expectation, use case template. Jefferson has been putting together some proposal on the, there is a GitHub with a dummy ID to try to steer the work on the development of use case template. Jefferson also shared a couple of on the mailing list about how to move that forward, having a kind of use case template that we can all agree on and have common description of the use cases. I think this is more to support the work. And finally, the last point in this consideration is connection with the internet classification. This is something we identified quite early in the development of the internet classification work, where if we have use cases, in fact, we could try to see the different criteria that the internet classification work is defining. I mean, the use cases could be really examples how to apply this classification. And I think it was time to have these kind of tables in the draft or that we can use, in fact, to position the use cases with respect to the internet classification. So these are a few of considerations we can have for this use case work. Then there are these 4.2, 4.3, a bit the questions about what as a group we want to do with that. And just before I leave the floor, also maybe to Luis, Jefferson, others that have shared interest in that, that we got some positive feedback on the mailing list and point to point by several of the research group participants that they will be interested in progressing this work on use cases. So Amina, Luis, Jeff, Jefferson, myself, Alex, I mean, we have been expressing that we'd like to move forward with that. So I think it's more a matter of agreeing on how to do that and maybe allocating time, meeting times or working session, offline working sessions to really make this happen. So time to have this discussion about what we want to get out of these use cases. And I really like, I mean, comments from anyone here. Am I the only one in the call?
No, not really.
So,
Lohan, maybe I can, I don't know if someone is going to talk. Sorry?
Guys, what you could do is if you put your name in the chat, at least we can see who will be interested in giving a thought on that. I think we have Jeff, Jefferson, Luis probably wanted to make comments. Any one of you, but just make sure we don't step on each other's toes. Luis, please go ahead.
Okay, so I will try to comment. I sense some kind of echo. Not sure if, well, okay, I will try to comment. So regarding the expectation of the work, yeah, I think that clearly there could be a demand of handling a complex scenario with in a simple manner. That simple manner would be the intent, and the complex scenario could be the targeted use cases. So going to the specifically to the use cases that I am involved to, there are two, the transport slicing and the interconnection. What is the complexity behind all of them? Well, in the case of the slicing, probably the biggest complexity could be found in the slicing use case, the overall slicing use case. And because the complexity is why is this complexity? Because it involves several other areas, the run area, the core network area, the transport area. and also because it involves new stakeholders. So thinking, for instance, in these non-public networks that could involve vertical customers, vertical industries that probably are not so much skilled in the way of managing the network, and so probably the way of simplifying for them the possibility of specifying the needs of slicing will be through these kind of intents. From the overall intent involving radio, involving packet core, and so there will be a piece that will be related to the transport. And probably these potential customers could not be so much skilled in order to specify actually how could be the realization of the slice, but only maybe SLOs, some parameters that to be satisfied for the particular use case. And here is where the slice, the intent applied to the transport slicing could take place. And here the beauty is also that there is an ongoing work in the TIS working group, and probably this piece could complement that work. And what this piece could facilitate would be the portability of the solution for different potential implementations that could be behind the network slice controller that is being developed in ITF. That would be from the transport slicing use case. The other one for the interconnection use case, there the complexity that we foresee is that somehow we foresee that interconnection would evolve. Today, basically, it's an interchange of IP traffic. And for that, we establish the BGP session and no more than that. But in the future, we do foresee that could be something else on this trading between operators, between parties. And that else could be the information about computing capabilities available, about even service function available, in such a way that the operators could compose the service function chain in different domains, or even make use of these computing capabilities for deploying virtual network functions on top of them, or even edge capabilities around for different applications and so on so far. So this probably this need of growing the interconnection probably cannot be expressed in simple way through BGP sessions, let's say, or through the specification of BGP sessions. We need something else, and probably the intent could be that could solve that part, no? How to express and how to express needs and policies to apply and so on so far. So these are the use cases that we do foresee by now that me and my co-authors of interest, and what we could expect essentially, no, the way of how to formalize the way of expressing that, and probably here the discussion on templates could apply very well. In such a way, how to structure, how to somehow determine a common framework of understanding between the parties, because the intent at the end is something that involves several parties. So we need a kind of common language for them, or a common semantic or syntax and so. So this is at least these are my thoughts, and I'm not sure if you, Logan, would like to something else from my side, or is enough maybe for triggering the discussion.
Thanks, Luis. I mean, I'm raising hand as a participant. I'd like to comment back on what you said. I saw that Jefferson also wanted to speak. So if Jefferson, if your point is on something else, if you allow me to go first.
Yeah, that's fine, because it's on something else. You go.
Okay, thank you. Luis, thanks for again raising this proposal. I think this is really consistent with what you said already last time. I have a couple of observations. First, if my understanding is correct, you have a couple of drafts right now in energy, at least on those topics. But I think they are not in the shape of a use case, and I think it was on purpose because you are looking for to achieve something a bit different with your initial draft. So my question is whether you will be willing to create a new draft, or if you think that the use case aspect will become a kind of section or an appendix in one of your drafts. So it's more about how you see that the work could be developed either in the existing draft or as a standalone document. This is the first question. The second thing is, I remember we talked some time ago about one of the projects you are in with Panayotis 5GE. And I remember this was a trigger of the initial draft, but maybe the focus has changed now. And I was wondering if also the participants of 5G Eve and maybe the outcome of the research will be fed into this kind of use case documents that you are talking about, or if this is a bit now on a different path, just to understand also, I mean, what we can expect from that. And it's really a question of commitment.
Oh, okay, so starting by the last regarding 5G intends to deploy 5G, let's say complete 5G services, so including vertical network functions, transport needs, but also radio capabilities and so on so far. Within this project, we are focused on intent mechanisms in order to facilitate those vertical industries to request the service that they want to be deployed. And so how going, scrolling through a number of menus and so in order to determine the needs and providing the system is able to request more information if the information is not enough for deploying the service and so on so far. But this is the end-to-end, let's say, 5G services, 5G service. From that, what we consider to move here in NMRG was specifically the transport part. So to somehow to take the subset of requirements that could be applicable to the transport, understanding that the transport could be the main focus of the group, right? But the 5G, if it goes farther than that. So in this respect, somehow, or at least in my understanding, I would say that yeah, we are bringing the use case to NMRG, limited to the transport, but at the end is the same kind of use case. So what could be requested for a 5G service? In that respect, it's not clear to me your question about the use case or not, because my understanding is that this is the use case, how to implement, how to request through intents a transport slice. And in this respect, what we could expect from progressing the work for sure to understand or to elaborate more on the mechanisms for processing the intent and derive from the intent the different SLOs that later on could be requested through the MBI through the network slice controller, the one that is being developed in ITF. So somehow closing the gap between the intent and the real controller or trigger the implementation into the network later on. So this is somehow the storyline. Probably I didn't make it clear, but that would be the part. No, so complementing with the intent capabilities what is being done in this working group. And how we would expect to evolve the work, if again elaborating more on the capabilities, how to deal with the interpretation of the intent as expressed by the customer and so on so far, probably elaborate more on how to provide the feedback part for closing the loop of this intent and ensure that the intent is accomplished as requested by the customer, and finally if we somehow are able in this other track of elaborating on the templates and so try to leverage on that formal specification in order to create or elaborate on the slice intent for transport. But this would be my answer. Not sure if I answer your question properly.
Yeah, thanks for it. Person, please.
Thanks for her. Now, I'm just to point out what you shown in the slide. I set up this GitHub in order to collect some opinions on the common structure of a document, and also I think that in the last meeting maybe we discussed some of the ways to move forward. So there is this question of having a single ID or several IDs, and I think this is something that we not have some kind of agreement on that. And also, I believe that we can we have talked with some people on the mail list about the willing to contribute on this document. But I believe that at this point, maybe we should move to define which are the topics that should appear in a document like this. Because I know that there are other kind of other ideas on the IRTF that have this kind of approach as a use case document, but in fact they are different in structure and the sections and what are expected from this document. So I believe that this is something that right now we should pursue some kind of agreement on what to do to move forward considering the document. Because I think we had some presentations on that, but I'm not sure how to move forward with the work, the more concrete work on this topic. I don't know if some hands has some opinions on that. Appreciate.
Yeah, thanks, Jefferson. I give you my opinion again as a research participant. What I see today is that we have two candidates, I mean, research participants and topics that they are working on their topics. So this could progress the work on a use case aspect. And also, you put together this template. And I remembered what we did in the animal time about this. It was quite useful. But what I see today is that maybe it will be more if we let the different authors or different participants that if they want to progress with their own document and let's let them do a bit of their work first. And we start this discussion about the template, maybe once we have a bit more matter to discuss, especially mm-hmm. more than case progressing. I think we have Luis, Panayotis, I think Amina also highlighted that she'll be willing to work on this 5G slice life cycle based on intent. I have ideas about other potential use cases, but we have to see what contributions could be moved forward with that. So I think your proposal makes total sense, but I think maybe it's still a bit too early because if we don't have the material to put in, it's a bit like an empty shell. So that's one observation. Yeah. So leave maybe the documents live their life. The second is when you say we have a set of documents or a single document, it connects a bit for me on the 4.2. I mean, what we want to achieve as an end result, mm-hmm. especially. I think in the development we can have individual documents, and maybe what we could have more towards, and if people agree to that, is to move part of the material, part of the outcome of the use case, collective documents, but we just put there, for instance, the lessons learned, some of the conclusions, so that it becomes more the commonalities or you see the use cases together. That could be a single document. If we try to describe all the use cases in a single document, maybe it will, not sure it will be really worth it. But this is again just my opinion as a participant on this aspect of templates and one versus multiple documents.
Yeah, I believe in regarding the ANIMA use case document, I believe that that point, the goal is to bootstrap the group. So the beginning of the document, I believe it's for the buff of ANIMA. So maybe one thing that we can work before, because I agree with you, maybe it's too early to start to define the document, but maybe we can define what we expect from this document. Maybe some kind of which are the ultimate goals of having a use case document at this context. So, you know, more in a sense that what one can do with this document. So Maybe this is it's a more realistic approach.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So, other comments.
There is some question, Laurent, in the chat. One from Jeff, so I can read it. So it's, do you have any views on potential use cases in UDC networking?
Yeah, that's the question I raised towards Jeff.
Oh, okay. Didn't get, and there is one comment from I think it's Alex. I'm a bit hard to read the name, but Alex was basically asking maybe Nikhil if he will have also some use cases from his side. But maybe it's a bit early today. I think it's first meeting, but Nikhil, if you want. If you want to comment on this question from Alex, please be free.
Yes. So this is my first meeting, so I'm mostly listening in this meeting. I'll be happy to share some of the use cases that we see in the field. We are mostly focused on the enterprise DC as well as the WAN parts of the network. So I'm happy to share some use cases that we see in the field in a future meeting.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, Jeff. Need to unmute myself first. Yeah, so we discussed 5G network slicing site. Luis said everything I wanted to. We started work on the draft. There's an ongoing work in TS. We just got the definition draft adopted as working group document. So we should just go ahead and start aligning things. With regards to data center, yeah, that's what I do in my free time. So the use cases are really building data center networking, taking high level intent instantiating networking. And I did a presentation data center a couple of IRTFs ago. Nothing really changed since then. We could go in details what needs to be done in data center, but practically moving from routing knobs and stuff into outcome intent-driven design for everything. From discussion, should it be SAS, maybe IBGP or EBGP, to there's number of things you're trying to achieve in data center networking, and they're well known. Basic routing, micro-segmentation layer 2, micro-segmentation layer 3, VLAN stretching. That's pretty much most of it, right? So I would definitely like to specify them more explicitly if a research group feels there is need to. So that's what I want to say.
Yeah, thank you, Jeff. I think, as you say, that there are clearly some potential use cases in the data center networking space. But I think this is maybe also an area where there are maybe the most advanced in terms of actual deployment of IBM technologies. So a bit my question more for the research group and especially research in research. Networking use case discussion or investigation is what will be the role of the research group in that thing? Is it to gather feedback from deployment or real applications, or is it to really question some of the opportunities or technical challenges in IBM use cases in data centers? Or it's the same question also maybe for the other technology, but my point here is, use cases for definition. Right? And how we map it to the research question, the outcome we want to produce on this kind of use cases. So this is a bit my what I have in mind, so I don't know if it's clear or not. share a comment?
Yeah, like I think I wanted to, it's something similar to what you were saying. The first, I have two things I wanted to have a chat about. The first one is kind of to ensure that these are really IBM use cases and what makes them different from traditional service use cases, you know. So do we need to have some criteria in terms of what's inside or what's outside our domain, like in terms of, you know, compared to the use cases that we had before for service orchestration, for example, or network management. So that's something I was thinking, maybe we have to ensure that they are innovative and, you know, that they are IBM use cases. That's the first thing. The second one is in relation to the connection with intent classification. What I'm suggesting maybe is that we could use the methodology there or taxonomy there as a kind of starting point to see where we have, you know, you were saying that there would be different documents and then there would be a placeholder with some maybe pointers to the other documents. So maybe we can use intent classification there and for defining where we have use cases, where we define use cases, and where we don't have use cases. And understand the coverage, really.
Mm-hmm. Okay, makes sense. Yeah, I think really, I don't know if it's too obvious, but I think right now I see that we have one concrete proposal, the work led by Lewis, and I really would like this to move forward. Ideally, I really encourage people to maybe also propose additional use cases or even on the mailing list to suggest that that could be interesting to look into, or the comment you made, Olga, that when we are looking into use cases, they should really qualify as intent-based and not reshuffling of what we have seen in the past already. I really like to encourage that we try to have an honest discussion on these use cases, because at the end of the day, if after multiple attempts, we don't manage to have more than one use case, okay, then be it, we have one good use case, that's the outcome of the research group, and that will be fine.
Should we have some criteria in terms of it has to be about the whole life cycle, for example? We can't have only provisioning or assurance or at least some kind of criteria like that.
Okay, this I don't know. I see
or
that
technology. Sorry.
No. Go ahead, Olga. I'd like to answer to you and then give the floor to Alex, but please finish what you were saying.
Yeah, maybe some guidelines in that respect that we are recommending, you know, if there are ideas about use cases, that they are kind of more about the whole life cycle, or at least more than just provisioning or assurance, or that we have some kind of combination of intent-driven provisioning and assurance, or, you know, some kind of migration, network migration, or recovery or something.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, on that point, because I mean, I know the slot is really not a good one for our friends in Asia, but we have recently seen a proposal from, I think it's colleagues from China Mobile on network measurement intent, and we got some comments back to them in the last meeting. I really think that this kind of proposal would also be a good candidate to look into that as a use case, because information you expect to get from networking environment or different systems that you are monitoring could also be a good thing to say what kind of intents you want to express, what are the functionality that needs to be configured and put in place to answer this kind of information request, visualization aspect of this what they call measurement intent. And I like to at least start a discussion with those colleagues about whether they want to steer a bit their work towards describing it as a use case. And I think to reflect to what you said, Olga, that you see typically a kind of network measurement intent may not address the full life cycle, but at least some of the typical phases or functionality that needs to be involved could be quite well highlighted into this specific portion of the lifecycle that measurement intents is asking for. So for me, this is one idea I have in mind. I'd like to give comments back to the authors of this draft about potentially steering this work towards this kind of use case discussion. And after that, I'd like to give the floor to Alex, and then after Alex, maybe is in the line.
Yes, hi. Actually, I didn't want to say much. I just want to respond on your earlier question regarding the value of those use cases. And I think, I mean, just in support of those use cases, I want to make the just a statement that I think this is very useful also as a test case, if you will, for a lot of the other concepts and support that we're discussing here, because it's always useful to have actually a pool of examples that we would need to be covered or to apply these things against to basically have actually really a reference set of examples, if you will, that we can use to instantiate perhaps some of the more abstract concepts and so forth that are being that we're proposing and discussing in other context. So I think that to me is a real value of the use cases, and this is why I think this is a worthwhile effort. That's all.
Thanks, Alex. Mehdi?
Yes. So I just want to comment on Olga, what she was saying, and I completely agree with Lauren about the idea of, I mean, I see her point about having the full loop, for example, but it might take more time, and I think it's quite interesting to have different pieces. And if you remember, Olga, you were there, and Laura also in Rome, like a year or two, I think in NOF 19, I think 2019, and we saw different demos, and most of them, at the end, if you remember, we did like an exercise where we tried to map each demo, each POC for different part of the loop. And some of them, they were just tackling the measurement. The other ones are doing, for example, the mapping, the verification. And I think it was interesting. And at the end, maybe we can kind of join them all together. And so I think, I mean, it doesn't have to be like the POC or the use case have to kind of cover all the whole loop. I think it's interesting to have at least some pieces of it. I just want to say also that from my side, we are working on some kind of business intent where you kind of allow some kind of high-level persons or the people that they take decisions. They're not maybe having the knowledge of the network that they can take decisions using, let's say, human language, whatever. So part of it, there is some measurement part, which has kind of nothing to do with intent, but we try to link it to use the data collection to use it for the sort of the AI and like or knowledge base or knowledge layer, to kind of use this data to kind of help the intent layer to kind of take better decisions. I mean, right now we kind of we were planned to do the demo. I was planned to do the demo, I think, in the last IoT the IoTF event, but we couldn't manage to do it. But yeah, I mean, so far we have kind of a demo or a use case where basically you can kind of do this kind of service protection period where you kind of protect the network from any modification during a certain period of time, and also kind of do some rerouting traffic, et cetera. But we also working now in this kind of device update or upgrade where you basically ask the network to use some kind of business intent, whatever, to request some hardware upgrade or update. And so the idea behind it, so without doing any kind of physical, human modification, the idea is automatically you kind of drain the traffic from that device, let's say, or a bunch of devices, and inject. Before that, you have to do kind of sort of CI/CD process, or using this kind of, let's say, twin network to do some testing and check if the code is fine and everything is working smoothly and there's no impact with the existing intent. And once everything is done through the intent, you can say, just apply it to this and these devices, for example, or this area. And so automatically you have to drain the traffic, apply the new upgrade, and put back again the traffic, or change the routes to make the traffic go through that the updated devices. I don't know if it makes sense.
Sorry, can I just reply, or do I have somebody else in the queue before me?
No, maybe just thanks, Mehdi, for your inputs. And yes, it makes sense. And if you can move forward with that, that will be very interesting for the research group. And please, Olga, you're next in the line.
No, I think, Bhakti, that's quite innovative, you know, and you are talking about different stages there, like, you know, when you are making the changes in the network, you are affecting the existing intents and things like that. So there is a kind of, it's not full life cycle, but it's impacting the life cycle of different intents, and there is a conflict there. And, you know, so from that perspective, it is IBN domain. So in terms of the life cycle, I was more thinking when we are talking about network services, not the business intents as those that you were mentioning, but when we are talking about, you know, slices or the connectivity in general, in that case, maybe we should ensure, of course, full life cycle is very complex, but at least that it's not just single function, that it is more than traditional use cases that we have in MEF or previously in TMF.
Yes, thanks, Olga, for raising this point. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I see Jerome is taking, I think it's Jerome taking his note, but I think it's quite important to capture all those aspects we don't want to lose track of when we develop the use cases. So probably, maybe this could be in form of comments in the template or some files we can keep on the GitHub, something like this. Will be useful to keep an eye on that. Is it better? Can you hear me a bit more loud now?
Oh yeah, that's better.
Yeah. Maybe my mic was on the wrong side. So I was just mentioning that what Olga was the comments from Olga. I mean, a couple of orders that we should try to capture that and either document that in the GitHub as comments in the use case template or in some other way so that we don't lose track of that. My comment is, in fact, my raise hand for comments is I remember also that in ops area, I think there was some work that Benoit Claes and some other colleagues of him have presented in NMG and in ops area. There was also a work in the hackathon on they call it SEN, so it's service architecture for intent-based networks, something like this. And I'm wondering if we should also try to at least work with them as a kind of candidate use case, what they are doing in this service assurance aspect. Maybe because I think they have concrete plans to, I think they are also proposing a young models and an architecture. So, and obviously if they participate in the hackathon, some concrete developments. So probably this could also be a way to collaborate with other participants about the potential application of IBM technologies. So wanting to know if you think this, we should try to get them more engaged, or if it's a bit too different from what we are looking for. I think Alex, you've been in touch with Benoit on this at some point.
Yeah,
Sorry, can you please repeat the question? I was distracted.
Well, yeah, I was just raising that you see, Benoit Claise and his colleagues have been proposing the service assurance for intent-based networks in Ops area and also in the hackathon. And Benoit made a couple of presentations in NMRG about that. And I was wondering if this could also be a kind of candidate use case and if we should try to get more engaged with, I mean, Benoit and the other authors about a potential IBN use case on that approach they are developing.
Oh, we can do that, but actually, okay. It didn't strike me really actually so much specific to the intent here. I thought that basically these use cases were lower level. Yeah, they were assurance. So they were service assurance based, but not, yeah. So, okay, I don't have a clear response for you right now. Sure, it's always good to talk to him, but I don't have it didn't strike me specifically as belong here specifically to IBN, but I guess I'll need to go back and look at this.
Okay. So maybe this is something we have to discuss a bit with Benoit and others if it fits in kind of really IBN type and not assurance only. Okay, thanks.
Yeah.
Any other comments on this activity on use cases? Also with respect maybe to the, you see the point 4.2, what we would like to achieve with the use cases. I recall that we are trying to do some research outcomes. So I think we should keep that in mind when we develop the use cases work. What if we think that there will be a document or a set of documents on IBN use cases coming out of NMRG, and they are published in 1 year from now, and if people read them in 2 years, 5 years, what would be the value for them? I think this should also drive us in understanding what to document in those for those use cases. And also 4.3, okay, maybe this is a bit more obvious, but common description, I think it's clear way to describe the use cases, but do we want also maybe through those to try to highlight specific requirements that could help us to test or to enhance the functionalities that we are identifying for an IBN system? Do we want to sketch common functional blocks that we see across the different use cases? Maybe what type of validation aspects we want to document? It's really to see a bit what you think we should try to see in those documents.
Sorry, just a quick response. I'm not quite sure actually why we would do this as part of the use cases. I think this may be something, if we have the use case, this is something that we can do, of course, as part of the other of the other documents. But I don't think there's anything specific about the use case for to do the validation. Right? I mean, presumably this is precisely why I think the use cases are good as a test case. But really, the more general concept should be applicable beyond use cases. Not really specific, right? I mean, I don't think, yeah, I mean, yeah. When we talk about the validation architecture, right? I mean, we have, for instance, in the concept definition draft, we talk about this, we talk about, yeah, a number of related aspects that I would, and I think that while the use cases are a great test case, basically, to apply these towards, I would not see that there has to be anything in parallel or anything separate that would be applicable only or be specific only to one particular type of use case.
Okay, thanks, Alex. Other views on this discussion point?
Laurent, I would say that probably when each of the use cases, because at the end we have different ways of realizing the intents, probably from that effort of understanding what could be the different situations, probably we can derive the common modules that you refer that, or even dependencies, or even gaps that need to be covered with respect to the different technologies that we could use in the realization on. So probably we don't have yet the answers to the questions that you are putting there, but I think that once we develop a little bit more the use cases, we will start having this view. No, maybe we are yet a bit early for answering this, I think. Let me put an example. So thinking on the slicing that we were referring before, trying to link this with the work that is being done in TIS working group, for instance, one of the starting points from TIS is that the northbound interface that will feed the network slice controller should be technology agnostic. So this somehow is conditioning how the intent should be expressed, because it should be technology agnostic as well. So maybe in some other cases we don't have this, we are technology aware. So maybe once I start detailing the cases, we start identifying these kind of things that will probably help to answer the questions that you're putting there.
Okay, thanks, Luis, for sharing your view, which I concur. Because I capture something you mentioned that you see on this transport IETF network slice intent, this technology agnostic. I mean, I fully support this, and I think it's part of properties of a well-defined intent system. I'm wondering if you see. Yes, we should be, I mean, the some aspects should be technology agnostic from the user or the application point of view for the intents. But I think also one of our goal here in this IBN activity is to be, I mean, I try to phrase it, intent-based technology specific. I mean, we have to develop, in fact, the intent-based technologies. I think intent-based is technology agnostic for its applications, and this is a characteristic of it. But I think what we have in front of us is the fact that the intent system or the intent technologies are not really well defined right now. I mean, we have some companies working on that, some specification here and there, but I think especially for the use cases, we need to identify what are those technology specificities that define the intent functionalities or capabilities that people will use in their different applications. So I'm not saying that you have an answer on that. It's just that the word you mentioned about being technology agnostic in the use cases made me react on that we have to find the balance between technology agnostic application of the intent aspects, but also that to enable this, we need to ourselves put right the actual IBM specific technology to make it work, to make it happen.
Yeah. Here I think that there are two dimensions. One, the aspects of the intent-based system itself, and then the technology aspects of the service. When I was referring before, technology agnostic was about the realization of the service. So what is intended to be passed to the network slice controller is something that does not prevent what is the kind of technology that you will use for implementing the slice, which is different to the technology of the intent. But probably these are two dimensions to consider. What kind of technology we use for the intent system, if the intent can be expressed in an agnostic way of the technology of the intent-based system itself, and also regarding the service behind of the intent or expressing the intent. If we need to detail the technology for implementing that service, or if it's something agnostic. But I agree with you, basically.
Okay, good. With respect to the agenda, if there are no further, inputs from the participants on this discussion, I think we can try to move forward with the next point. So I think this will be quite straightforward or quick, depending on the feedback we got. But so agenda item number five, IBM activities outside of energy. So again, this is not a comprehensive landscape analysis, but it's just to bring to the attention of the research group that, I mean, I've been made aware of a couple of either starting on ongoing activities that relate specifically to IBM. So one is in the HCZSM ISG. So the ZSM stands for Zero Touch Network and Service Management. It's an industry specification group in HC that looks into zero touch, end-to-end network management, et cetera. And one of the new agreed work item is a group report, which is on intent-based management. So the number of the work item is ZSM 11. This is just starting. It has been adopted in December, and we have first contributions going into this report. But from the knowledge I have on this document, the scope is, overlapping to some aspect, to some extent with what we are doing in energy, especially on the definition of some intent models, some functionality like intent conflict resolution, and also trying to position different interfaces. I mean, the definition of interfaces between participating technological domains. So at least I think it will be of interest for the research group participants to be aware of that. And depending on what will be publicly available, to also maybe review or take into consideration, in fact, potential development of work in HCZSM about this this intent-based management. I don't know exactly what will be the impact towards energy, but at least wanted to raise this now. The second area is on the TMF, Telemanagement Forum. There is an ongoing autonomous networks project that is quite active, and it's threads, in fact, technical threads of activities. And again, to my knowledge, they have published, or it's being published, a first version of their technical architecture. So it's broader than just intent-based networking, because it's an architecture for autonomous networks. But intent-based aspects are one of the key technology pieces inside of this autonomous networks architecture. And to my knowledge, there will be some activities ramping up on more specifically intent aspect, and especially towards intent modeling. I think some activities on APIs developments related to intent or intent-based APIs. And so again, this is to bring it to the attention of the research group. I think this will also be quite in line, or at least overlapping with some of the activities of the research group, and that we should, I mean, at least take this into account. And so my question is really open, is if we need to take any position with respect to those activities, if we want to try to have some collaboration, review the documents, participate into those organizations, or at least, I mean, maybe this could also impact some of our documents. Really, this is really to give you the information and see a bit what you would like to do on that. Olga, you have a comment?
I was just wondering, maybe also at CNE, is it, or do you think it's
ZSM
or at CNE would also be quite relevant for intent driven.
Sure. I mean, it's IENA is clearly in scope. And as I say, this is not a comprehensive overview. It's just that those two activities are a bit more recent, I mean, or starting or become more active. I mean, the ZSM 11 group report is brand new. So contributions are only starting into that. I didn't mention IENA is just because, to my knowledge, the IENA work on intent is ongoing. So it's something we have always been aware of. But of course, it's also in scope. It's not to exclude things, it's just to report on, let's say, most recent news that only from my point of view, I've been aware of. And of course, if anyone is willing to share relevant information on IBM activities, especially in standards or in open source, this is most welcome. My point is also to know if anyone in the group thinks that we should become more active into either collaborating or making ourselves known to these groups, or if it's okay, they do things, we do things, and it's nice. I really have no prescription here. It's just sharing information and getting to know if you would like that we energy could support any collaboration actions or organize reviews or joint meetings, whatever. It's just really for collaborative things.
Yeah, Jerome speaking. I think there was a comment from Jefferson that this says that we should support and collaborate outside of NMRD. I also agree with that, and I think this is something that we should benefit all. I think there are, of course, a lot of activities outside NMRD regarding IBM. It's hard to follow all of them for sure, and nobody can. So at some point, I think it would be good to have a kind of joint meeting, maybe with a kind of, even we know that there are other activities, as you say, in the different group well-established, like in AI, it's good to have a joint meeting at, with maybe with all the group or several groups that everybody can present, and we see at least what happens in all the group in a very summarized view. I think we can try maybe to see if we can have this kind of meetings. And I think, yes, I think we need this because we cannot just live, live in our bubble. And, you know, we have a lot of questions with what you want to put in intents, and we can also have we can also find maybe some answer from our question regarding other use case or maybe a concept from other. I think it's important that keep in touch. Of course, if you have people that are involved in the different group and can also give feedback, I mean, in other group can give feedback here, it's very important as well. But I think somehow we will need to have this kind of, as you say, joint meeting to be organized.
Okay, thank you. So, I mean, this could be an action point on us, Jerome, as you and me as research group chairs. But I think we can also maybe contact a few of the research group participants. I think from our affiliations, implication in some of those groups, we may have also some connections that could facilitate, if there are some area of collaboration, to organize, as you say, joint meetings or exchange of documents, and maybe joint participants are in both areas benefit from that.
Yeah, I think actually the first action point would be to list some of these people in our groups that are either directly or indirectly involved through colleagues in other groups. And you say that it would be more facile, easy if you have already connection, even if they are not direct.
Yeah. I have colleagues in TMFAN active, and we shared. I presented the status, what we were doing to them, and they presented to me. But I could ask if there is a need to kind of for them to do any presentations if you want, or we can point them to them. Thank you to them.
Yeah. Okay. Let's organize this. I think Jerome and I will come back to the research group research.
And of course, with Annie at CN, if you're interested, Bill is active there. So.
Yep. Let's see what we can work out for this. Okay, good. Any further thoughts on this, other activities and what we can do for that? No? Okay, so let's move to the next agenda item, which is status on using AI for network management. This is a bit short notice. So Jérôme, I don't know if you have any news to share on the development of the document, or what could be the status for that?
Actually, the status is the same, but I think it was in December or just in November when we discussed last time. There is no major news. I think, to progress in the Git document, I will we will in another meeting organize a dedicated session. I still have to somehow think on the mailing list and to have some feedback on what could be the next meeting if we go through a certain use case as we as a certain challenge as we've already discussed, to see if we try to detail one challenge serve as a basis for the description of others, because I think the let's say the other section around, like introduction section and so on, are now in a quite, let's say, not stable, but still I think it's enough comprehensive, and maybe now we should go again into the content of the challenge itself. But it will need probably dedicated session to let some or continue to progress in the document. So no big news.
Okay, thank you, Jérôme. At least my take on that would be that we had some good meetings where we had inputs and comments from participants. Let's see how we can try to build on this momentum, either through a bit of a summary on the mailing list, or trigger something either via the mailing list or, as you said, with shaping the document for an internet draft with GitHub. The thing is, I think there are expectations, and people were actively try to be actively involved. We have to see how to support, in fact, the activity. I know we are all very quite busy, but I think there are good opportunity to progress this document. As you say, some of the discussion have stabilized. So we should try to see how to move to the next level of detail for this one. Okay. Good. So let me see what's next. We have still a bit of time in front of us. Any other topics, any other business you would like to raise to the attention of the research group? Could be on any topic in the research agenda, or questions you may have towards the work of the research group, future meetings, whatever, anything you like to discuss. We have a bit of free time now. Just while you are thinking about the next question you may raise, I'm showing now a slide that we project usually is future meetings. One question is whether we're going to organize an online interim in February, knowing that it's already quite late January and the next IATF is, I think, mid of March. So we have to see if we can squeeze one. As Jérôme just mentioned, maybe we can also take opportunity to have dedicated meeting on progress of the research challenges in AI. This use case activity also, I remember that having work session was quite, we got some positive feedback on that. So maybe not I will say kind of full interim meeting, but maybe more topic dedicated ones could be organized ad hoc. Let's see what we can squeeze before March. And for your information, we requested a 2-hour session for the next IATF meeting. So hopefully we will have an NMG session in March together with IATF 110, which will be fully online again. And the text in blue, just I think you're well aware of that. We try to continue with working with monthly or roughly monthly virtual meetings. let's try to use more the mailing list if we have technical things we'd like to elaborate, and also use our collaborative platforms. Some of the IDs are on GitHub. We have also some activities on Google Docs, but whatever is useful, please use that. And if you have any suggestions, please reach out to the chairs. With that, at least on my plate, that's all what I had for you today. Again, any other questions, comments, things you would like to share with the research group? Okay, so if we are done for today, thank you for your participation. Thank you, Jérôme, for taking the notes. We have a couple of action points, I think, on the different topics we discussed. We have some draft that will be updated and having some last call. So we have a few things ahead of us for that. And again, thanks for being here, and have a nice rest of the day wherever you are, or rest of the week. Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you, Laurent. Thank you all.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye. Bye.